sorry, what was that?
Oh,
okay. Welcome back, Rick. All right. Well, this Sunday we're commemorating Memorial Day this week. And so that's what this service is about. We're going to have an active meditation. So you all have candles to participate in. And there's little stones there too, so more will be explained by that. So people don't burn themselves, when you light your candle from the Christ candle, we want you to put your candle as close to the center candle as possible. And the logic and the reasoning is so the next people don't have to hop over all those candles and possibly burn themselves. So if we could just keep that in mind, and the chaplains, of course, will be behind the tables, and they will guide you. Okay. So let us center and let us say our affirmation three times with a pause between each time. Let us begin. Jesus Christ is now here, raising me to his super consciousness. I realize that I am the image and likeness of God. We welcome everybody. We know that we are all made in the image and likeness of God. So everyone has that Christ essence in them. We pray for all the children of the world. May they be loved and loving. May they have all their needs met. And may they have the possibility to really reach their divine potential and share their gifts with the world. And Unity's World Leader's Prayer for Peace through the Christ Mind. You are unified in thought, purpose, and understanding, and are inspired to right action for the good of all. And for world peace, in the name of Jesus the Christ, we pray for and decree a permanent peace, uniting all the nations of the world in a league of justice and righteousness in which the life, liberty, and love of God shall be paramount. Amen.
My God, over the sea, I
Chairman
everyone today. We're so glad you made it here. Probably a lot of people are away this weekend, but I love seeing the faces that are here. This is our spiritual home, where we come every Sunday and we pray, we meditate, we go to classes, and mostly we enjoy the friendship of one another here. So we're really happy you're here. Okay, we appreciate the talents of our musical team, Laura McKee, the choir, and Hector Garrido.
Features Paul Collins on trumpet. Now, time for vitamin H. So if you don't want to get a hug, you need to put your hand out. Ready?
Good job. How you doing?
Don't worry, I know.
Howard, who will be giving us a Hospitality Loving Hearts team update, followed by Carol Quinn, who is our prayer chaplain for the day.
Thank you, Sandy. Hello, my name is Joanne Howard, and I was asked to give an update on two of our sacred service activity teams. And the first one I want to talk to you about is Loving Hearts. Now, when I started coming here probably about a year and a half ago, I noticed that there was this little pamphlet on the front, and it gave a list of all of the opportunities for being able to volunteer. And on there was one called Loving Hearts. And that title just drew me, because so I said, you know, let me look into this. And it said, you send out cards. And I said, you know, I don't do that. I would love to do that. And, you know, my heart would become more loving if I sent out cards. So I looked into it and found out there was no team leader, so I became the team leader. And that was how I started in it. But then another person called Patty Cox, it's just the opposite. She loved to send out cards. She was doing it on her own, sending out birthday cards to people. And then Reverend Marge said, you know, would you mind being part of Loving Hearts? And she said, I love it. So she became part of Loving Hearts. But she's not here 12 months a year. So another wonderful person, Lisa McCarthy, stepped up and said, well, when you're not here, I'll do it. And that's how I find things happen in Unity. You know, you think of something and it happens, and before you know it, all comes together. That's the way it is. And so, the other team I want to talk to you about is hospitality. Now, what is hospitality? Well, when you're invited to come to the community room after a service, we are there. A hospitality team is there to help you. And so, what is hospitality? This is my uniform, by the way. Hospitality is a sacred service opportunity for all of you to participate in. And, you know, when you would welcome your friends to your home, you greet them when they walk in, and then you offer them a cup of coffee afterwards, and it's kind of welcoming and fun. Well, that's kind of what we do. We give you the cup of coffee, a little bit of refreshments, and those kinds of things. But in order to do that, we need people to help us to do that. And right now, we have a leadership team in place. And the way it's going to work is the team leader and four captains. Each Sunday would have a captain. And so eventually, the leadership team would be team leader and four captains, making decisions and listening to the people and seeing what the suggestions are and making the experience a delightful experience for you. So we also have a need for kitchen angels. We need three people in the setup section to set everything up before the service. Then we need four people in the cleanup after you have your refreshments, and you know, you can do that. It only takes 30 minutes a task. So if we've got three people times 4 weeks, that's 12 people. If we have four people times 4 weeks, that's 16 people. It's a total of 28 people I need to kind of run things there. But I found that people that work in hospitality are so giving that when people are not there, all of a sudden, everybody shows up to help. So that is wonderful. But I'd love to have 28 people. I'd also like to have a substitute list of four people. And I really want a waiting list of people who are dying to get into hospitality, and when the opportunity arises that they can do that. Also, I've heard people say, well, you know, I'm not here 12 months a year, so I really don't want to sign up for something. And my answer is, so if you're here for 3 months, sign up for 3 months. We can do that. Some people say, well, I can't get up in the morning, so I'm here 5 minutes before the service. Fine. Do the after, do the cleanup. I've heard some people say, oh, I have to go to lunch with my friends. The answer is, come early and help us. So there you go. Please join us in the community room. We'd love to interview you, place you, and train you. Thank you.
Thank you, Joanne. Would all the chaplains in service please stand? These chaplains will be available at the end of the service to pray with you. We do have rooms on either side if you would like a little more privacy. We are always honored to be of service to you. I also want to take a moment and say that every member has a prayer chaplain. We just recently shuffled the list around. If you missed your call or you're not sure who your prayer chaplain is, you can contact the office to get that information. I also want to acknowledge that this is Reverend Marge's last service with us, and a time of transition, so the chaplains are prepared to help us all through that time. And I was reading Spiritual Prosperity by Eric Butterworth this morning, and I thought this was appropriate to read to remind us, why not pick out the most difficult thing facing you right now and say, I know that this is the best thing that could happen to me, for I know that in the happening there is revealed a new lesson to learn and some new growth to experience. I know that within me is an unborn possibility of limitless potentialities, and this is my opportunity to begin to give birth to new ideas, new strength, and new vision. I accept the reality of the difficulty, but not its permanence. I am not at the end of anything. I am simply between opportunities, between jobs. I know that in the movement of it has come to pass, something wonderful is on its way for me, far surpassing anything I've ever known before. And if I should feel the slightest irritation of fear or anxiety, I will say to myself, all right, let's get busy curling, as does the oyster. Now, back to what I should be doing. This is the Daily Word. It is available in our bookstore for purchase. You can also get it online or through Unity. The reading today comes from Psalm 118, verse 24. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. The word for today is wholeness. My mortal mind may be eager to focus on perceptions of lack, creating shadows across the energy of the day. Yet what a gift it is to realize that this day is whole and complete, waiting for me to discover it and appreciate its unique energy. I am one with the essence of love and abundance that is my experience of the divine. Anything that may seem to be missing is merely an illusion born of my limited human perception. Today, I affirm wholeness in everyone and everything I encounter. Through my perceptions of wholeness, I feel and express the fullness of the spirit I truly am. I choose to live this day as a whole and complete experience. Can you join me in saying the affirmation?
I choose to live this day as a whole and complete experience.
Thank you. The spiritual power for the month of May is power. Corresponding color is purple, as is on this tapestry, beautifully designed. The center of power is located at the root of the tongue. Power is the ability to master, have dominion, and control. Power is represented by Mary Magdalene and the disciple Philip. Mary Magdalene traveled with Jesus as one of his followers. Please help me say the affirmation. Remember soldiers and the protesters, everyone that has brought us to this day. And we pray for a higher consciousness, and that we have peace in the world. And may we be bringers of peace and love in every moment and every day. In Jesus Christ's name we pray.
Take several seconds to read this Albert Einstein slide and quote. And after my truth, the power of a prayer chaplain, I will tell you what the slide means to me. I have two younger brothers. The three of us live in Florida, about 90 miles apart. However, that was not the case until 2016. One brother, an acupuncturist, lived and practiced in our northern Wisconsin hometown. It's a small town with one main street that serves a large area midway between the two metropolitan cities. In early 2015, Fred had a nervous breakdown. A police wellness check determined he was suicidal. He was admitted to a mental institution, diagnosed, and in rehab for 6 months. He remains perfectly normal now, as he was then on maintenance medication. He moved to Florida to be with us to escape the Wisconsin winters. Initially, he stayed with us while his house sold in Wisconsin. Unable to reciprocate his license to Florida, I prompted him to find a local job. Fred had no interest. He helped around the house, but lacked motivation to do anything unless prompted. He was always moping, primarily being unable to practice acupuncture. My brother and sister-in-law agreed to take him when a room became vacant upon graduation of my nephew, and a room was available for Fred. So they took him in. Still no interest in looking for a job. Our prayer chaplain called for the first time after an absence. It was Reverend Marge filling a chaplain vacancy. My prayer was my brother find the motivation for employment to supplement his income and be engaged socially. Reverend Marge had met Fred and developed some thoughts. For several months, we repeated the same prayer during our call, but there was no result. In November, she asked, what was the family doing for Thanksgiving? And I replied that everyone was coming to the villages to have dinner. Reverend Marks suggested that I change my approach to interact with Fred. Rather than verbally beat him over the head and making him feel bad, why not go for a walk and tell him about his positive qualities? She saw him as outgoing, willing to interact with people, and in turn, people appreciating him. I thought about this Einstein quote and what Reverend Marge suggested. I changed my quality of thinking to a higher consciousness energy to dial the frequency required to obtain a different result, a positive reality. So after dinner, we went for a walk, and I pleasantly surprised him when I simply told him what a wonderful person he is. I elaborated on his positive qualities. People like him. I appreciate him. I thanked him for his friendship and our lives together. Next week, he found a job. This is the power of a prayer chaplain affecting change in our family. Change projection, change perception, change energy, and change reality. Thank you.
Next to the break. spoke about the somberness of war and conflict and presented the concept that there's another way. This song says that we should celebrate life, and I hope that you enjoy it. Again, it works really well.
So I do.
The first one is Carol Quinn. There's going to be a change to the ASAP prayer chain. When that's worked out, you'll know all about it through the email. Dan Wolf, who spent much more time than he ever thought and originally planned to get our Vantage phone system working, and up it is. And Carol and Gus Bruno, who have had had to meet many landscapers and on our prayer spiral, which promises, it started, and it promises to be completed by Tuesday. So that is wonderful to walk. There's going to be a nice path there. You set the intention before you start, come into the circle, be open to guidance, and then when you return, you give back. So that'll be a wonderful place for you to go right out that door and walk right in it and use it. The only announcement I have is there's an angel workshop by a good friend and author Tom Carpenter happening in June. He's a very learned, brilliant man, and he has served on quite a few Unity boards. He's been in Unity forever. Okay, a couple jokes. A pastor's wife was expecting a baby, so he stood in front of the congregation on Sunday and said, I kind of need a pay raise. So after much discussion, they passed a rule that said whenever the pastor family expanded, so would a salary. So after six kids, this started to get expensive, and the congregation decided to hold a meeting to discuss the pastor's expanded salary. There was a great deal of yelling and inner bickering. Imagine that. It ensued to figure out what we're going to do about the pastor's additional children that were costing the church and that could potentially cost a whole lot more. So after listening about an hour, Pastor Andy rose from his chair and spoke, and he said, children are a gift from God, and we will take as many gifts as God gives us. Silence fell over the congregation in the back pew. An old lady struggled to stand and finally said in her frail voice, rain is also a gift from God, but when we get too much, we wear rubber boots. So the congregation rose and said, amen. And one more, there's an attorney and a senior citizen. They're seatmates on a lengthy flight. And the lawyer's thinking that seniors are not quite at the top of their game, and he could get one easy on the senior. So the attorney asks the senior if he'd like to play a fun game. The senior's tired and just wants to take a nap, so he politely declines and tries to catch a few winks. The attorney persists, saying that this game is a lot of fun, and I ask you a question. If you don't know, you pay me $5. Then you ask me one, and if I don't know the answer, I'll pay you $500. This catches the senior's attention, and to keep the attorney quiet, he agrees to play the game. The attorney asks the first question, what's the distance from the earth to the moon? The senior doesn't say a word, but reaches into his pocket, pulls out a $5 bill, and hands it to the attorney. Next, it's the senior's turn. He asks the lawyer, what goes up a hill with three legs and comes down with four? The attorney uses his laptop, searching all the references he can find on the internet. He sends emails to his smartest friends. No avail. After an hour of searching, he finally gives up. He wakes his senior and he hands him $500. Senior pockets $500, goes right back to sleep. The lawyer's going nuts, not knowing the answer. He wakes his senior up again and says, well, what goes up a hill with three legs and comes down with four? Senior reaches into his pocket, hands the attorney $5, and goes back to sleep. Surprises, he concludes that warfare has been around since prehistoric times, a Although it's hard to distinguish whether our ancestors died in conflict within a tribe or a group or conflict between opposing tribes based on the archaeology, in either event, killing occurred fairly often, and one is left with the inescapable conclusion that life for the hunter-gatherer, for our ancestors, was often short and violent, with a high percentage of each tribe or family group being killed or wounded in any given year. So using archaeology and anthropology in addition to historical research, he makes a very good case that as an agricultural and animal husbandry slowly ended the nomadic existence for many people and spawned the first Western civilizations in Egypt and Mesopotamia, warfare still remains quite frequent and violent, although the imposition of order and structure within the group decreased some killing overall. Now, the second part of the book, Gad examines the current trajectory of war and whether open conflict between states and societies is truly on the decline overall. And again, all the people who reviewed the book, drawing on a large body of knowledge and recent work, he comes with an interesting conclusion, and he says that peace has been the overall trend for the last 200 years, even with the cataclysms of two world wars and several socioeconomic and psychological factors, which he describes in great detail. So we are on a trend to peace. We can imagine over thousands and thousands of years that research and what has done and the killing, but we're on the cusp of a trend to finding another way and to actually living in a world of peace. Now, I really like that slide, this slide here. I like this slide a lot because it's sand and it's water, and we can either be in the flow with what things happened, or we can fight the current. Also, you know, we can put a line in the sand between people or among people or among groups, but then as we use forgiveness, the water washes that line away and then we are at peace again. So what we do know is when there's no warring within us, within each of us, that then there will be global, everlasting peace. And what will that take? Well, Thich Nhat Hanh, he said most of the sufferings people experience in relationships are not really caused by others, but themselves. And he says, listening to and understanding our inner suffering will resolve most of the problems we encounter, that we all need to pause and stop and heal ourselves. And of course, that's what we do in meditation. We listen, we see what bubbles up, we work through it, and move it from our subconscious mind. And then another Buddhist teacher in a book called Practicing Peace in Times of War, Pema Chodron, she explores the origins of aggression and hatred and war, explaining that they lie nowhere but within our own hearts and minds. And then she goes on to describe different methods, which anybody can YouTube. There's lots of YouTubes with all kinds of peace teachers and Buddhist teachers. But she says it has to do with our thoughts and our actions. The more that we fill our mind with things spiritual, the more it seems like we are actually tuned in and walking in our divinity. We get clues to the inner workings of our minds, of our subconscious mind, when we're quiet. And we become aware of what might be driving our patterns that we might not even have ever been aware of. So to date, just to date, we have one planet. That might not always be the case. There may be people living on Mars in the next century. But right now, our goal is to really figure out a way to live in harmony with one another. And so what will it take for us to transform? And this is a great image there. because it kind of shows a steering wheel with the peace symbol, kind of a steering wheel if you use your imagination. And it means that we are really at the wheel of our transformation, that we are either going to drive it forward or just to stay in neutral. It's up to us. Now, unity gives us a way with the unity principles to use our transformation. Now, we haven't seen this in a while, but this is the oompa. This appeals to the people who are more auditory learners. So we have here that there is one God. I think everybody knows that there's that presence that permeates all things, the rock, the sky, the innate life, everything. There is a God. And when we say there is a God, there is life, light. That's how we describe God. And if anybody still has doubts about that, they need to look up on the internet that God particle, where they created that thing way down in the middle of the earth, and then they found out that where there was supposed to be nothing, there was something. There was a force there, and that's what we call the God force. Now this second O is we're one with that. This is really the crux of the unity teaching, this one right here. Because when we realize we're one with that God force, we live our life totally different. We know that mind manifests. When we know we're one with the God force, we automatically pray much of the day. And when we know we're one with the God force, we take the action. So what is it going to take for us to realize we're really one with that God force? It has to mean that we have everything in alignment in our life. So whatever we fill our minds and our life with is part and parcel to our divinity. So that means our books, our movies, the friends we spend time with, those are all high consciousness. It means those high yielding investments, they're all good for the planet. Because why would we want to assault our divinity in putting a part of our energy into money that is destroying the planet? We wouldn't want to do that. So when we actually realize that there is a God presence, and we say at the beginning of every service, we are one with that. When we wake up in the morning and we say, I'm activated by the God force, then our whole life is different. All the choices that we make are different. So I really believe that that second principle is the most important principle. Because then we take the necessary action, and when we realize we are one with the God force, we want to transform as much in this lifetime as possible. Because why stay in neutral when we can live in a higher consciousness and move forward in our spiritual life and in our maybe lives to come? So once we have control of our minds, we let it all flow. Like that peace and the water. We just remain unattached, and we look at everything with deep curiosity. We draw our own line in the sand with conversations about what we'll participate in and what we'll not. You know, there's always one person in a group when somebody starts to gossip or get on a negative spin that stands up and says, hey, wait a minute, I don't want to listen to that. And then the group changes the conversation. So in unity, we accept everyone. And somehow we've gotten it all wrong by expecting them all to walk in unity principles. Now this takes time, doesn't it? Babies learn to crawl first and then grab and reach for things as they try and steady their wobbly legs, getting used to standing. Alo, who's not here today, he's right at that stage. And so we must all be patient with one another. because as someone said recently who came in for closure, that, you know, even if you've been in Unity for decades, sometimes it takes more than that to really get it. Really. So we've all witnessed from time to time, maybe in other churches, maybe here, that people attend classes, but then there's no behavioral change. That's a little discouraging, but it is the way it is. The next generation is the one who will usher in peace, that will bring in a new earth, a new consciousness, and they really, most of them have already remembered who they are. They understand they can do anything on the planet. They are the God selves. And so what we can do is support them in all their actions and all their activities. And if you say, oh, I don't want to, you know, it's time for me to retire, well, get on the web and get active in some of those groups so you can support those new people, the millennials who are doing the change, because they are ushering the change. Namaste. Let's see, is there anybody here for the very first time? Okay, one person here, welcome. All right, well, let us give you a blessing. We love you. We love you. Okay with that, Emily? Okay. So as we get ready to go to directions first and then we'll get quiet space. So there's two things up here. The ushers are going to light the Christ candle. And then you can take your candle, light the Christ candle, and you can light it for someone you know who died in the war or anybody. And then there's also a little box in front of that with these little stones. And I don't know what they are, but they're kind of one of these things. And what you can do is you can take one of those and you can put it in your pocket or your wallet. And when you see it, see if you can remember for that day how you were more peaceful. Some kind of way that you are making, we're all making ourselves more peaceful. So let us just take a moment and center ourselves. And giving thanks for all the people who were so brave to serve and who were killed in war, and also the deaths in the dreams of those who have come back and have quite a part of a piece of their physicality removed or damaged, and so have had to really adjust their lives for that loss. That is something also that we honor. And so as you come up, let's just intentionally light the candle for those souls who have given themselves and more, knowing that there really is another way and that we are on an upward trend. And we're going to try to keep the candles close to the Christ candle so people don't burn themselves. it's up to us to create that peace-filled world. And if we keep that little stone in our pocket and feel it every once in a while or in our wallet, it'll remind us that it is up to us, and the small acts all aggregated really will make global world peace a reality. Amen. So instead of the prayer for St. Francis, we're going to say we remember them. Let us begin. And rise
of the sun and its glory down, we remember them.
At the glow
of the wind and the chill of winter, we remember them.
At the opening
of the buds and the rebirth of spring, we remember them.
And
at the blueness of the skies and the warmth of the sun, we remember them.
At
the rust prosperity. The best way to expand your prosperity is, of course, to give. And as we give, so we receive. So we are, we tithe, when we give our blessings, our gifts, we are giving them to a world that works for all, a world that's more sustainable, a world that is kinder, and a world that is more peace-filled. I saw a button last time I was in North Carolina, and it said, "Make American kind." Gifts in our hand as we affirm divine love that has me, blesses and multiplies all that I am, all that I have, all that I give, and all that I receive, and I am grateful.
My name is
Stephen.
Thank you.
So one of the things I would ask is if you're, if we keep these lit through our peace song, and if you're a wobbly kind person, you don't want to be by the table to play. So we want people who are steady on their feet, you have to be behind them. All right, so now how am I going to pray with? How am I going to do this without Myla? Thanks for the givers of these gifts. We give thanks that all the givers of these gifts they participate in their spiritual growth and really realize that it really is up to us. And there's always we can support the new generation to bring in the solutions. And so we see these gifts, these offerings, these tithes, we see them expanding and multiplying exponentially. See them really going out into the world to help those who are changing the world for a better, more beautiful, more heart-based world. And for this we give thanks in the name and through the power of Jesus the Christ. Amen. Amen. All right. So let us get in our peace circle. I'll push this out a little bit. So we're going to get behind
us. Okay, you can get her. She's
excited to remember them.
I don't know. Check it out.